Hi, I'm Cosmina. Welcome or welcome back to our channel, where we aim to give you high quality in-depth technical videos, camera reviews, and post-production tutorials. In this video, I will go through the data collection and analysis protocol I made for looking at exposure levels in order to get the best looking image at each ISO for the three different types of RAWs you can get out of Sigma FP: BRAW, CDNG, and ProResRAW. All the clips were recorded at the same time using the same set, lighting, and camera settings. Each of them will be reviewed in a separate clip. At the time of this recording, I just managed to finish analyzing the BRAW clips, so hopefully I won't have anything else to add for CDNG and ProResRAW. These are the main things we'll be looking at in the next clips. 1. The visual difference between the RAW file decoded using camera metadata and BM film for BRAW and CDNG. 2. Clipping point and shadow recovery, also known as headroom and legroom. This is the official Sigma FP dynamic range, so this is roughly what I'm expecting from my results in terms of headroom and legroom. I'm most interested in the clipping point, especially for the lower ISOs, 100 and 200. For the cases where we want to shoot outside in broad daylight and we're forced to use very low ISOs for any particular reason. 3. Visualization of exposure compensated clips for overexposed and underexposed clips. Four, maximum shadow recovery. 5, noise level. Here we'll have both a visual inspection of all the clips, as well as calculated noise levels using the Neat Video plugin. 6, color shift. For now, I've observed a significant color shift for several of the underexposed BRAW clips. The higher the ISO and the more underexposed the image is, the more pronounced the color shift is. Firstly, I want to have a bit of a rant about exposure and why I'm making such a big deal out of it. We've had previous comments saying that the exposure shouldn't be talked about so much since you can just overexpose by 1, 1.5 stops and be done with it, which is mostly true. But I still think it's very important to be aware of the camera's limits, to know exactly how much you can overexpose or underexpose at each ISO. This is useful in situations where the environment or type of shot you're trying to achieve is limiting the options that you have. For example, if you're shooting a commercial indoors and you need to keep a constant f4.0, let's say, and you have a limited amount of light available, knowing whether you want to be underexposing the image at a lower ISO or overexposing at a higher ISO can make a significant difference in the amount of noise you will get in your image, which for a commercial type project is very important. Or perhaps you have a high contrast situation outdoors on a sunny day and you only have an ND8. If you need to capture the details in the highlights, it's very useful to know the individual clipping points for low ISOs, ISO 100, 200, even 400, because it might be worth closing the f-stop a few stops more and shooting at ISO 400, let's say, instead of 100. Secondly, I just want to briefly define a few terms. We say that an area has clipped whites when the area is so bright that you can't recover details from it if you pull the highlights and/or exposure down. We say that an area has crushed shadows when the area is so dark that you can't recover details from it if you pull the shadows and/or exposure upwards. The range from standard exposure, 18% gray or middle gray, to clipped white is called headroom. The range from the standard exposure to crushed shadows is called legroom. We set up to shoot for all three RAWs in the same go. That is, CDNG on the Sigma FP, the Ninja 5 for ProResRAW, and the BM Video Assist 12G for BRAW. The test was run in 2 batches, which is not ideal, because I couldn't reproduce the exact setting in the second batch. This was done because when I imported the clips from the first batch, I noticed that I could recover all the data from the areas which appeared clip on the screen or the external recorder when I was recording. So the second batch was done just overexposed by a whole lot, and it also required an extra light source to achieve the super high brightness. I wanted to create a high contrast environment where the subject has the highest exposed area of the image. High contrast helps us check out how the raw image deals with a whole bunch of stuff in one go for each ISO, like headroom, legroom, noise level, dynamic range, and color shift. It also lets us observe areas of high EV and low EV in the same shot. I used a Siconic light meter to measure the brightness of the light sources. The exposure value I noted for each of the clips was the exposure on the subject's brightest cheek, left-hand side of the image. I held the meter in front of the subject and pointed it towards the light sources midway between the two when both were on. I think my exposure error is about plus minus 0.5 EV. I think this is most significant when looking at the headroom, since to achieve such a high exposure, I used two powerful light sources at a small distance from the subject. Hence, the light is not very uniform, even on the left-hand side of the cheek where I measured the exposure. It is important to note that the value you get on your light meter is the accurate exposure for middle gray. This type of light meter is an incident meter, which reads the light falling on the subject and assumes the measured subject or area to be middle gray and gives you an average light reflectivity of the area. The incident meter is not affected by the brightness or tonality of your subject, so in the videos, what you will see as written down as original EV will be the exposure of the left-hand side of the subject's cheek, so the EV compensated for Caucasian skin is one stop over what the light meter measured. The best way to calculate the exposure would have been to use a spot meter. This tool is a reflective light meter and it measures the intensity of the light after it's been reflected off the subject. So for the same incident light, if you shine it at a black object and at a light beige subject, for example, the measurements will have different values. This is how a camera's meter works, and this is the principle on what false colors is based on. The next best thing to using a dedicated spot meter was using the false colors that our external recorders have. By the way, you should be aware that on April 20th, Sigma FP came out with a new firmware update that added false colors to the camera. At the time when we shot these tests, we didn't have it though. It's worth mentioning that on the FP screen and on the BM recorder, you see a Rec. 709 image, so much more crunched down image than the actual RAW you get when you import the image. On import, you see the same image at the beginning before you change settings in the color tab. It's the same as the camera metadata image that you will see in the next videos. This makes it difficult to know right off the bat if your image is going to be clipped. In contrast, you can set your Ninja 5 monitor to PQ. This shows a very good approximation of the raw image that you will have on import and Final Cut after you've applied the HDR tool. So this is a much better tool to expose the Sigma FP on. The BRAW and CDNG clips were imported in DaVinci Resolve Studio 17, and the ProResRAW clips were imported in Final Cut Pro 10. For BRAW and CDNG, I found it worth showing the BRAW and CDNG clips in two versions, meaning I decoded each clip using camera metadata once and using the BM design color space the second time. This was done to better illustrate how much leeway you have in your raw image versus what you see on the FP screen or the monitor of the BM recorder. The BM design color space gives you the actual raw file where you can recover the most from both the highlights and the shadows. For each of these clips, I used the false color plugin from DaVinci, so you can clearly see the exposure levels as I underexpose and overexpose for each ISO. What's good about how this plugin works is that it knows how to correctly map the colors for each ISO according to the dynamic range, taking the legroom and headroom into consideration. The plugin doesn't have Sigma FP as a camera model, but the Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Camera 6K looks to be a good overall approximation. Here are the official dynamic range specs for the two cameras. I also checked the false colors map shown by this map against the false colors shown on the 12G video assist during shooting. They look exactly the same. I did, however, see that for some clips, it fails to recognize the clipping correctly. I still haven't figured out why that is. I also used this false colors map to determine what exposure level other elements of the image had, which I had not measured directly. Namely, the toy which I used to show the noise level for very underexposed clips for each ISO. For ProResRAW, For previous videos, I used the false color plugin from Time in Pixels in Final Cut Pro 10, but lately they have been having issues with it. I can't change the false color's preset and other settings to match my camera model and ISO. So in order to maintain a consistency between all the three RAWs workup, I used the HDR tool on all the clips and adjusted the exposure for each under and overexposed clip. I found the best image to be given by HLG to Rec. 709 SDR conversion. I then exported them in ProRes 422 and imported them in DaVinci and used the false color tool in there like for the other two RAWs. I didn't see any significant differences in exposure or color between what I saw in Final Cut and the export. I didn't show two versions of this RAW in the dedicated video, since there is already a way to see the real RAW preview of the image when you're recording. The bureau grading consisted of correcting for exposure and bumping up the saturation and contrast from the Blackmagic color space to make the image look as much like the camera metadata image as possible. The gamma control settings applied were the same for all the clips. The only thing that varied was the exposure correction. All these corrections were done in the camera RAW menu. The ProRes RAW grading consisted of just correcting for exposure after the HDR tool was applied. The noise level was measured using the app Need Video. For a good noise profile to be built, one must select a part of the image which contains noise but no features. I found one such part to be an area in the left-hand side of the light switch. It is important to note that the EV levels used in the subsequent graph analysis were of that area. I've approximated the values using the False Colors plugin from DaVinci Resolve. I looked at the color shift by selecting the curves button in the color tab and the histogram option from the scopes. For the curves graph, the lower left of the curve graph represents the blackest potential point of the image and the upper right represents the whitest. The horizontal axis represents the luminance range of the image itself and the vertical axis represents the offset of that luminance range. This histogram provides a graphical representation of each channel's tonal distribution. The x-axis shows the brightness, where 0 is absolute black and 1023 is absolute white. You can also go to the three dots pictogram here and change the waveform scale style. I used the percentage scale. The y-axis shows the number of pixels. You can also look at it as representing the amount of data, frequency or intensity. ISO 3200 example. In terms of data sampling, I used the bureau graded clips to look at the color shift. I defined the shot as being color shifted when the features of the RGB curves started flattening. In this example, you can already see a very slight color shift between plus 1.5 EV and plus 0.5 EV. So for the latter, I noted it as color shifted. I assigned the value 1 for significantly color shifted images, not 0.5 where there is a slight color shift, and 0 for images with no color shift. Since color shift doesn't happen for overexposed images at any ISO, I included data just from the plus 2.5 EV and images that had EV values lower than this. For the negative 1.5 EV clip, the curves are elongated. You can see this in both curves and histogram. This shows a higher image contrast. If we look at the histogram of the curves, we can see that for the overexposed to plus 1.5 EV images, the red channel is significantly more intense, has more data overall throughout the image. Whereas for the plus 0.5 and below, the intensity of the red curve diminishes a lot. In the shadows area, the green curve has more data than the red. In the brighter area, the red channel is still more prominent than the green. But because of the big difference in shift, the image appears shifted in green. I'm expecting to see similar results in all the RAW types except for the color shift data. I think the bureau will have the highest color shift in underexposed clips. Tune in for the next videos to check out the results. No.